All right, it's good to see you tonight. Good to be in the Lord's house. Appreciate you being here. And we've got several folk that are sick tonight that we need to pray for and keep them in our prayers. Brother Tim Worthy is sick tonight, so pray for him. Sister Henrietta is sick tonight. Brother Mickey had a procedure done today and wasn't able to come tonight, and they're going to go ahead and schedule him for surgery sometimes pretty soon to remove his kidney. And sort of figure that might be one day next week. So pray for Brother Mickey and pray for the Lord's will be done concerning him. Pray for Sister Patty. Keep her in your prayers. And Brother Lee Fox fell again. So pray for Brother Lee Fox. And he's having a lot of problems with his balance. And so pray for him. There's a number of folk I know. I'll probably leave somebody. Brother Jesse's still in the hospital. Keep him in your prayers. And they're going to change his... The port that they do is dialysis on tomorrow, so pray for him. And Sister Becky said he's just not doing any good at all. He's just getting weaker and weaker. So keep him in your prayers. And I'm sure I'm missing somebody, but we'll take prayer requests here in just a few moments. But let's remember these especially, and we'll begin our service. Let's stand, if you would, please, and we'll go to the Lord in word of prayer. And just pray for these requests and pray for our service tonight. Pray the Lord to just bless us and visit with us. Give us a good time. May the Lord Jesus be pleased in all that we say and do. Amen. All right, Brother Dennis Bishop, would you pray for us, please?
Take a hymn book, turn to page 314. If you need it, we're going to sing all four stanzas of Amazing Grace.
His grace hath brought me safe.
you, congregation. You may be seated. Pastor's going to take prayer requests now.
All right. Let's talk up good and loud tonight so everybody can hear you, if you would, please. I failed to mention also Lainey and their granddaughter had that surgery, and she's, what I understand, doing okay, but they're going to be there in Texas for about the most of the month of May, looks like, as she recovers. And so you pray for them while they're there, and pray that the granddaughter recover totally and completely. All right? And also, somebody else was sick tonight, and I thought about it, and I forgot it that quick. Maybe I'll think of it in a minute. Let's get this side over here, please. Anybody on this side? Teresa? Okay. All right. Karen? Okay. All right. Brother Bill? Okay. Miss Ann? Okay. All right. Miss Wilma? Okay. All right. Anybody else on this side? In the center? Zane? Jadette. Okay. Denise? Okay. All right. Amen. Brother Jack? Okay, all right. Nate? Okay, sure will, buddy. Okay, Diane? Okay, all right, Vesta? Sister Norma? Okay. Okay. All right. Linda? Okay. Made me remind me, pray for Sister Dizzy. That's who I was thinking about a while ago. She, Brother Jimmy said she might possibly broke that foot again. So pray for Sister Dizzy. Brother Robert? Okay. All right. Brother Donnie? Pray for Brother Donnie. He got a bruised rib or something. Pray for him. We got him on injured reserve or 15-day disabled list or something. I don't know. We haven't decided what we're going to do with him yet. We might just shoot him. Amen. Rick Rack. Pray for your dad. Sure will, buddy. Bless you. Okay? Amen. Hey, that's right. Praise the Lord, brother. Amen. Yes, sir. That's all right. Pray for Linda Johnson's mother. Brother Lawson said that she's not doing real well. and may have to have surgery. So pray for Linda Johnson's mother. And keep Willie in your prayers, too. He still has a lot of problems. Okay? Anybody else in the center? Tori? Well, still the mother, so that's one. That's 50%. That's 50% of it anyway. So pray for them as they go tomorrow. Everything will work out, you know, for that little girl and for Tim and Cassie. Jack. Amen. That's right. Anybody else in the center? Over on this side. Little Danny? All right. Pray for all of our military people, where they're at. They're all... I used to say pray for those in harm's way, but if you're in the military, you're in the harm's way because you're subject to be anywhere at any time. Cora? Sure will. Anybody else on this side? Cindy? Okay. Pray for your mom. Anybody else on this side? Anybody else here? Edward? Yeah, I mentioned it. The fox falling, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Dustin? All right. Okay. Boys. Men. Okay. Anybody else? Don't forget to pray for our revival. Our homecoming is Sunday. Be sure to bring a well-filled basket and a big appetite. And then our revival will begin on Monday night. Pray for Brother Stacy Shefflett. He'll be coming and preaching for us. Pray God would use him. And we're gonna serve supper each night. And we need all those that will make themselves available to help each night. We're going to start serving sometimes between 5 and 5:30, but no serving after 6:30. So after 6:30, we're going to cut it off because we'll be running in time to start our service if we go any longer than that. But if you get here by 6:30, you'll be able to get your plate, and you got 15 minutes to eat. Amen. So that's this coming week, so you keep that in prayer. Don't forget this coming Saturday at 7 o'clock in the a.m., our men's prayer meeting. You men bring your Bibles this Saturday. And, we don't do nothing but just pray that God will just send us a good revival. We got plenty to pray for this week, so keep that in mind. Pray for the youth meeting on May the 24th, and those of you that are planning on going to the down to Columbia to the zoo, You got to put your name down and how many. When you put your family down, I got no idea how many is going to be in your family. So these are people that are faithful. Now we're going to start doing this. We're going to start doing this for those that are faithful to our Sunday school hour. And so we want them to get them involved, get them in Sunday school, and come in and be a part of that, and that'd be a blessing. So if you're going to go, you better put your name back there, because we got to get the tickets ordered. Then the ladies' Mother's Day banquet, which is going to be May the 11th. There's a sign-up sheet out there for that. So far, there's nobody on that list. The ones that put it out there ought to put it on there. So start signing up for that, and that'll be on May the 11th. All right, we got all our prayer requests. Man, has anybody got a praise? Thank you. Sister Joyce? Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Brother Jack? Amen. Except Donnie. Okay. Hey, you know, we get all these prayer requests, everybody just sort of, everything just seemed not to be going good, but the Bible says everything that hath breath, let him praise the Lord. And listen, if we're here tonight, we ought to be able to praise him. We ought to be able to thank him, because he's a good God no matter what the situation, the circumstance, and the conditions that we're facing. Thank God. We ought to praise him. Sister Patty. Amen. Thank you. Might just be the treatments. Amen. Hallelujah. It can still be that way. Amen. Hey, God still answers prayer. We didn't believe that. We don't need taking all these requests. But that's a blessing. Amen. All right. Let's remember these requests. And amen. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Amen. I think y'all to praise him. Amen. Brother, who else? Y'all pointing or raising? I can't. Edward? Amen. God, take care of us, Sister Karen. Yeah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Brother Rick. Amen. 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 Brother Rick Rack putting feet on them prayers. He's checking it out. Amen. All right. Carolyn. Amen. Yes, he's good to us. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's wonderful. Amen. I think you ought to just every now and then just praise the Lord instead of, you know, just exalt and lift him up. Amen. All right. Teresa. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. That's a blessing, isn't it? I like what Brother Bill said yesterday. We was out here working yesterday, and just out of the blue, Brother Bill said, somebody must be crazy when they leave this church. but anyway, I appreciate our people. I really do. What a blessing you are. Sister Cora. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Ain't he good?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. All right. If you know anybody else, we're going to pray.
No.
Amen. Yeah. Yes, sir. You can count on him coming through all the time, every time. Amen.
Amen.
Have not because you ask not. Amen. All right. We're going to pray. Everybody pay attention tonight now. Everything's taking place. It's most important. It's up here in this pulpit. And don't make the preacher have to be mean again tonight, okay? Just help me out. Let's worship the Lord and praise him. If you had any schoolwork, kids, you should have done it before you come. Do it when you get home. Amen. All right. Let's stand and go to the Lord in word of prayer. And ask God's blessing to be upon these requests and upon the services. Pray God to bless our church and our people. And thank God for the praises of God's people. Brother Steve, would you pray for us, please?
Thank you, Lord, for your goodness.
God, thank you for answering the request. Thank you for taking care of it. Thank you for the love.
Congregation may be seated. Brother Leon is going to come and sing for us.
Hey.
Thank the Lord tonight for saving me and all his many, many blessings on me and my family. And thank God for this church. As many said, we was able to come and just be a part of this just the minute we was came here. And I just thank God for having the opportunity to assemble here with y'all. And thank God for saving me, a hell-deserving sinner. And Lord reached down. Nobody in my family or anybody in my wife's family or anybody I've ever met till one day in December 92 when I got saved, but I'd never had anybody tell me that I needed to be saved my whole life till I was about 23 years old. So ever since I've been saved, I knew what kind of church I needed to be a part of, a church that was
Amen.
Desirable to see other souls saved. So I thank God for this Amen. Kind of church.
Cities that man has built that are wonderful to see. People travel far and near just to walk their busy streets. But there's a city that God has made where the streets are made of pure gold. The walls are jasper and gates are pearl. And the half has never been told. There is a city where Jesus is the light. There is a city, no need for the sun to shine, where all of the people who have knelt at the cross will walk in the streets of that city. The blood of Jesus has paid the cost.
Thank you, Lord.
There are cities that man has made where the buildings reach to the sky, where the people wear diamonds and gold for just a few years, then they die. But there's a city that God has made. The foundations are all different stones. And the people there all dress in white, and they will never grow old. There is a city where Jesus is the light. There is a city, no need for the sun to shine, where all of the people who have knelt at the cross will walk in the streets of that city. The blood of Jesus has paid the cost. There is a city where Jesus is the light. There is a city, no need for the sun to shine, where all of the people who have knelt at the cross will walk in the streets of that city. The blood of Jesus has paid the cost. We'll walk in the streets of that city. The blood of Jesus has paid the cost.
Thank God.
We're going to sing the song, Glory Hallelujah, Somebody Touched Me, Had to Be the Hand of the Lord. I think all of you know it. You can be seated and stay where you are. And when we start naming the days, Monday through Sunday, that day that you got saved on, if it's Monday, stand up and remain standing till we finish. If you don't remember what day it was, just stand up anyway and shout the victory. Amen. All right, let's go. Glory, hallelujah, somebody touch me. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Had to be the hand of the Lord. It was on a Monday, somebody touched me. It was on a Monday, somebody touched me. It was on a Monday, somebody touched me. Had to be the hand of the Lord. It was on a Tuesday, somebody touched me. It was on a Tuesday, somebody touched me. It was on a Tuesday, somebody touched me. Had to be the hand of the Lord. It was on a Wednesday, somebody touched me. It was on a Wednesday, somebody touched me. It was on a Wednesday, somebody touched me. Had to be the hand of the Lord. It was on a Thursday, somebody touched me. It was on a Thursday, somebody touched me. It was on a Thursday, somebody touched me. Had to be the hand of the Lord. It was on a Friday, somebody touched me. It was on a Friday, somebody touched me. It was on a Friday, somebody touched me. Had to be the hand of the Lord. It was on a Saturday, somebody touched me. It was on a Saturday, somebody touched me. It was on a Saturday, somebody touched me. Had to be the hand of the Lord. It was on a Sunday, somebody touched me. It was on a Sunday, somebody touched me. It was on a Sunday, somebody touched me. Had to be the hand of the Lord. Glory, 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 somebody. If he did, how about shouting it out? Amen. Somebody touched me. Glory, 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 somebody touched me. Had to be the hand of the Lord. Thank you. You may be seated. Right before the pastor preaches, for 10 minutes tonight, if possible, if you're able to stay, I want to go over one song. It'll take 3.5 minutes to go over that song. Now, I don't know how long it'll take you to get up here, but I want to go over a song, not practice it, go over it. If we know it, fine. If we don't, fine. Okay? All right? All right, Pastor, you come on and preach God's word.
Thank you, Brother Rick. I found out a long time ago when I used to lead music, there's really not a good time to have choir practice. It just doesn't seem to work out good for anybody. For the time being convenient or whatever, you just have to do it, amen. It's good to be here tonight. I appreciate the good testimonies of those that stand in that are saved. I looked around, everybody was saved. Or you stood up anyhow. Hope you didn't stand up because everybody else did. I looked around and I saw when some of you stood up. I remembered when you got saved. Yeah, some of you, as you stood up. But I'll tell you one day I never forget the day that I got saved. Amen. November 23rd, 1967. The Lord saved me on a Wednesday. Amen. Ain't been the same since. The old songwriter says, the wonder of it all, and I've never gotten over the wonder of it all. Amen? Well, I'm telling you, if I wasn't saved tonight, I'd get saved. I might get saved again if I could. Feels so good, amen. Let's have the ushers. Let's have our jug offering. Y'all play something real good. Verse of I'll Fly Away. So do one verse of I'll Fly Away. I'm glad one day we're going to do that. Riley? All right. That's a lot of folks' favorite song. Amen. Rick Rack said that's his favorite. That's a blessing, isn't it? All right. Praise the Lord. To all those that's not on security duty out there, I'd like for you to be in the sanctuary, please. All young people, report to sanctuary. It's one thing I like about the sound system. We got speakers in the bathrooms and the hallways. Got them in the fellowship hall. Yeah, there they come. Sometimes I guess I have to be encouraged. Aren't you glad for God's goodness toward us? Amen. I appreciate the presence of the Lord tonight. I appreciate feeling His presence tonight. Appreciate Him being here with us. What a good day it is to come in to be in the Lord's house and be here on a Wednesday night. What a joy. And like I've said many times before, you know, there's just something about Wednesday night that's special. And a lot of people just don't feel like there's no need to come on Wednesday night. Well, some people don't feel like there's no need to come anytime. But anyway, there's one thing about it. When God saved me, He gave me a desire to be in His house. And I believe that's what He expects us to do. And I believe that's what He expects us to be faithful to, is the Lord's house and to His service. And just rejoice in His wonderful name. This past Sunday morning, didn't get a chance to really preach the message, but I talked about a little while this past Sunday morning on God's divine ability. And certainly we know tonight how divine He is, and we know certainly what His ability is. He's able to do whatever He wants to, anytime He wants to, any way He wants to. And tonight, as we asked and the spoken requests that were made, people give those by faith, knowing and believing that God will answer. It's not if He can, but it's when he will. Amen? And I believe that with all my heart. But there's some things tonight that I'd like to bring up to you that God certainly is able to do. And I think that you'll agree with me. And I'm going to be considerate of the time and give Brother Rick enough time so the folk won't be too late tonight in leaving, and let him have a little short choir practice for the song. But don't forget, this coming week, revival. Don't forget, Monday night is family night. Tuesday night is friend night. Wednesday night is church night. Thursday night is youth night. The one that brings the most visitors for that 4 days, we're going to give you a choice of a new Bible or a $50 Walmart card. Now, if you take the $50 Walmart card, you better have a good Bible. Amen? So, we got some Scofield Bibles that we'll make available for those that want Bibles, but I know a lot of folk already have their own Bible and maybe not need a Bible, but whoever brings the most that week of those 4 nights, combined total, we're going to give you that choice, either a Bible or a $50 gift card. Hey, $50 worth of gas at Walmart, if you use them now, you can get 10 cents off a gallon with a gift card. So that's worth working for. So, and the thing about it is, if we can use something like that to challenge you to get your family here, if we can use something like that to challenge you to get your friends here, we can use that to challenge you to get some of your young people here. You know, it shouldn't be a problem getting our people here. They ought to be here. I mean, there shouldn't be a problem with that. But I'm talking about people that maybe attend church somewhere else that will be able to come that week to revival, or maybe some that go to church anywhere that you work with, and some of your family and your relatives and your friends. I'll guarantee you there's probably, all of us probably know a dozen people right now that does not go to church or attend church anywhere. And we all do all we can to try to get them under the sound of the gospel. And sometimes when you do something a little special, that they'll show up. Hey, tell them they can come and eat with us. Amen. And maybe that'll get them here. That'd be a blessing just to get them in on the sound of the gospel and hear them say. Because you know what? The God that we serve is able to do one thing, and I know He can do that. He's able to save unto the uttermost. The day that you got saved, the day that I got saved, the day that we felt the burden of sin lifted off our heart and our soul, when we were not worthy, as Brother Steve prayed a moment ago, none of us is worthy. None of us deserves it. None of us have done anything to merit the grace and the goodness of God in our life. Oh, but He did that just because He loves us, and knowing that God is able to save us, and the Bible says, unto the uttermost. Now, I've mentioned this before, that the word uttermost just simply means that He saves us totally and completely. Let me just say, once God saves you, you don't have to go back for a second helping or a second dose, or you don't have to go back for a booster shot. Amen? When God saves you, He saves you one time for eternity. Well, preacher, I just don't know if I believe that once saved, always saved. Well, You're in the wrong church, ain't you? Because we believe that. We teach that. God, you see, the Lord is not going to do something and then take it back. And I'm thankful tonight that he says he totally and completely forgives us and totally and completely saves us. So therefore, he will not go back on what he said he would do. The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews chapter 7 and verse number 25. This is that familiar verse of scripture that we've used many times concerning the Lord saving us. The Bible says unto the uttermost, where it says, wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Let me just say tonight, and I think we all know this, but let me just say it once again for the fact of those that may not know and for those that may be listening by the way of the internet, that there's no other way to God except through Jesus Christ. You can't get there through any other way, any other avenue, any other road. It's just nothing else works except the blood of Jesus that Brother Leon sang about that song a moment ago. Those that are in heaven are there because the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see that it's only by him. The word able in Hebrews chapter 7 and verse number 25 it carries the same meaning as the verse possible in Luke chapter 18 and verse number 27. And I mentioned that to you where it says, these things are impossible with man, but are possible with God. It carries the same meaning. The word able and the word possible carries the same meaning concerning this. And let me just say tonight that God's able and is possible for God to save every man, woman, boy, and girl that comes to the Lord Jesus Christ by him. Brother Steve, turn the air on a little bit, please. Sister Henry, I ain't here tonight. I won't get no mean looks, will I? I know it's getting a little stuffy here, and I see you fanning. I told him, I said, the thing about this, before you turn the air on, there's 12 fanning. After you turn the air on, there's 12 got blankets on. So there's no happy medium, evidently. But it will cool down here in just a few minutes, and it's a little warm to me, but I know sometimes it gets warmer up here than it does out there. But let me just say tonight concerning the possibility of God saving us, let me just say he's able and he can. And I've said this before, and I'll mention it once again, and you may have said this before you got saved. You may have said, there's no way God could save me. You may have said this, I've done so many things, and I've lived such a wicked life that there's no way God could save me. But the Bible says he is able. He is able to save to the uttermost. He's able to totally and completely save you and forgive you of all your sins. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2 and verse number 21, and it came to pass, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, you can't call on the preacher. You can't call upon your family. You can't call upon because your grandma and grandpa's buried in the church cemetery. Those things will not work. But the Bible says that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Why? Because it doesn't depend upon you. It doesn't depend upon anything else. But it depends solely upon God through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, preparing salvation and redemption to all mankind that will come unto him. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse number 15, Paul says to young Timothy, this is a faithful saying. Now the word faithful there just simply means that this is a true saying. And let me just say, every jot, every word in this blessed book is of the truth. Amen. I believe that with all my heart. And Paul says this is a faithful or a truthful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners of who I am chief. Paul said, there ain't nobody been no bad as I've been. And every one of us could probably make that same statement. Paul was a persecutor of the people of God before God saved him. There's no telling how many people Paul beat and put in prison and maybe even took some of their lives before the Lord saved him. And Paul says, this is a true saying. He said, I'm telling you the truth. If God can save me, he can save anybody. And I think we can say the same thing this morning or tonight. If God could save us, he could save anybody. And that's just the way it is, amen? And let me just say, the Bible says, and I think I heard Cora say something the other week when we was having testimonies about people, how sometimes we say that we didn't know that God could use us. But let me just say, if He saved you, He can use you. I believe that with all my heart. I believe that every one of us have a job to do and something that we can do for the Lord. I don't think He saved any of us to sit on the seat of do nothing. I don't think He saved. Now listen, everybody's not going to be preachers. Everybody's not going to be teachers. Everybody's not going to sing in the choir. Everybody's not going to play these instruments. Everybody's not going to sing specials. But I believe there's something that every one of us can do. And when the Lord saved us, if He's able to save us, He's able to use you also. So I thank the Lord for that. And let me just say, you can come unto Him. The Bible says in the book of Revelation chapter 22 and verse number 17, it says, "And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will come, let him take of the water of life freely." I notice two things in this verse. Number one, it tells me that no matter who you are, no matter what you've done, that you're able to come. And if you don't have money, you can come. You don't have to have anything. You come because it is a free gift of God through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me just say tonight, all the things that you see happening in this world, the wickedest of all sinners, God is able to save. God is able to save. Folk, our country and our nation's fastly and quickly going down the tubes. Boy, if you can't see that, man, I'm telling you something. Somebody needs to turn the light on for you. It's amazing to me how that a young man can play professional sports and want to wear John 3:16 on his eye black patches under his eye. And they want to do away with that. Don't want him to do that. But then somebody can, another professional athlete can come out and profess he's gay and come out of the closet. And the President of the United States of America calls him and congratulates him. How sad that is. How wicked that is. But I'm telling you, God can save every man that comes unto Him. If he'll just call out and cry out and admit that he's a sinner, God can save him. The Bible calls that an abomination unto the Lord. The Bible says that's wrong, it's wrong, it's wrong. But here we are embracing those things in this society that we live in. Well, preacher, you're sort of narrow-minded. Times have changed. Hey, times may have changed. This book hadn't changed. God hadn't changed His mind. What He said what He meant, and He meant what He said. He hadn't gone back on His word, and He's not going to change it for you or me or nobody else. Almost made me ashamed I was American. And I happen to think about our president probably is not an American. No charge for that. Well, preacher, you shouldn't all mix politics with religion. Wickedness. But I tell you right now, Jesus can save everyone that comes unto Him. I don't like what they're doing, but we got to love them. I don't agree with murdering and robbing. I don't agree with adultery. I don't agree with all them kind of things, but you got to love the people that's committed those sins. You know why? Because every one of us is guilty of something. Boy, aren't you glad Jesus loves you? Boy, aren't you glad He cares for us no matter what we are, no matter what we were, no matter what we've done. He loved us. You know, ain't it wonderful to know that God is able, that He's able to save us totally and completely and forgive us of every sin that we've ever committed. You see, there's not one that's not forgiven and not covered. You see, the Bible is so true and so plain. Look, if you would, please, over in the book of Isaiah. Let me read you a couple of three verses here. In the book of Isaiah in chapter number 55, it's a familiar portion of Scripture, chapter 55, and I want to read verses 1 down through verse number 3 and just join you that God can save whoever will, whoever comes, God can save. Isaiah 55 in verse number 1 down through verse number 3, the Bible says, "Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money," hallelujah, come ye buy and eat, yea, come, that buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore be ye, spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not. Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let you your soul delight itself in fatness. Incline your ear, and come unto me, hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even as the sure mercies of David. Aren't you glad the Bible says that we can come and drink and eat even when we don't have the money and don't have to pay for it? It's all free. It's a free gift of God. The Bible says that certainly all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. In Romans 6:23, the Bible tells us that every one of us today deserve hell. But because of the free gift of the Lord Jesus Christ that's been extended to every one of us, God is able to totally and completely to forgive us and cleanse us of all of our sins. Look, if you would please, in 2 Peter chapter 3 and in verse number 9, another familiar portion of Scripture. The Bible says, "The Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward." Thank God for that. Hey, I'll guarantee you there's probably not one person in this building that got saved the first time that God dealt with you. And a lot of folks, there's some people here in this congregation that people prayed for you for years and years and years before you got saved. And I'll guarantee you there was time, so many people were praying for you, there was many times before you got saved that God dealt with your heart and showed you that you were a sinner and showed you that you needed to be saved, but yet you said no, you refused, you rejected, you put it off. You better thank your God tonight that He was long-suffering toward us. Amen? If God, hey, God could have been just, and God could have been, He would have been just, and He would have been right if He cast us everyone into hell. But He was long-suffering to us. He was patient with us. Boy, sometimes our patience wears thin. I know mine does. I'll just be honest with you. Sometimes my patience wears thin with church members. They just don't want to serve God and don't want to be faithful and don't want to live right. They don't want to be in their place and don't want to be in their position. Man, I'm telling you, if God's given you something to do, you ought to do everything you can to do your best at it. You ought to be faithful. You ought to serve God. You ought to knock down the doors to get here and be in your place and do what God's laid upon your heart and God's called you to do. You ought to do everything you can to do what's best as you serve the Lord. The people today take their jobs haphazardly. But God is long-suffering toward us. And we ought to thank Him for that. In the Bible, let's continue reading. The Bible is not slack concerning His promises, but as much as some men count slackness, but it's long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Sort of does away with Calvinism. They say, well, there's the Calvinism. I'm a three-point, I'm a five-point Calvinist. No, you don't need to believe none of that. Yeah, there's some of those things you can believe, like irresistible grace. You can resist the grace of God. And many of us did before we got saved. Like I say, there's probably not one person in this building that got saved the very first time that God dealt with your heart about your sinful condition. I doubt. Anybody in here get saved first time? I guarantee you, people prayed for you a number of times before you got saved. Oh, you can resist the grace of God. Now, total depravity, every one of us, certainly we believe, all, every one of us is totally depraved. There's nothing we can do for ourselves than to help ourselves. But you see, we don't have to help ourselves because Jesus Christ, through the redemption plan that He performed on Calvary, made it possible, made Him able to save us to the uttermost. The Bible says in John chapter 6 and verse number 37, it says, "All that the Father giveth to me shall come to me, and all that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out." Can I say tonight that no matter what you've done, if you come unto Him and you ask Him to save you, He'll save you. I like that song. I think it's in our hymn book. We haven't sung in a while, I think. That song entitled, Whosoever Meaneth Me. Whosoever meaneth me. I believe with all my heart that some of the most wickedest people that we could think of tonight, if they would call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, He would save those people just like He saved you and me. I've said this before, Saddam Hussein, if he had called upon God, God would have saved him just like He saved you and me. And that man was wicked. That man took many, many lives and put many people to death. But God would have saved him if he had called upon Him. I think about these sex predators, and I think about these mass murder, serial killers, or whatever you want to call them, like Bundy and all. Let me just say, hey, if those men would have called upon God, God would have saved them. And am I right? Now, correct me if I'm wrong. Did Bundy make a profession of faith while he's in jail? Did I hear that, or I'm dreaming? He said that. Let me just say, you say, preacher, you believe in jailhouse religion? Philippian jailer got saved, amen. He's in the jailhouse. He wasn't in prison, but he was in the jailhouse. You say, preacher, you believe in deathbed repentance? Absolutely. You preacher, you believe when a person gets right down at the end of life's journey that they can be saved? Hey, if they call out to God, they can be saved. Why? Because He's able to save unto the uttermost. I believe not only that many completely saved, I believe there's no limitations upon who He can save and when He can save. I'm glad it's that way, amen. I'm glad it's that way as we trust our Savior for our salvation, knowing that He's able. Psalms 86 and verse number 5 says, For Thou, Lord, art good. Amen, I agree with that. And ready to forgive and plenteous in mercy unto all that call upon Thee. I mentioned a moment ago Romans chapter 3, verse number 23, where it says, For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says in Romans 5:8, that God commended His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You see, we were still yet in our sins when He had us upon His mind. I like that song that Brother David and some of the other folk have sung around here. When I was on the cross, when He was on the cross, I was on His mind. Oh my, how true that is. How true that is. Let me just say that the grace of God and the salvation of the Lord Jesus has not been in vain. Thank God for the many, many people that have been saved and the many, many people that have come to know Christ as their Savior that you and I just know of down through the years, how that they've been gloriously and wonderfully saved. Why? Because God is able to save. Let me just say, don't ever give up on your friends. Keep praying. Don't ever give up on your family. Keep praying. Don't ever give up. No matter how many times they say no. No matter how many times they say, I don't want no part of that. No matter how many times they say, I don't want to go to church. I don't want to have anything to do with church. I'm not going to church. Just forget it. Set it and forget it. I'm not. Hey, don't ever give up. If we give up, I believe we're doubting. And we're limiting God because God is still able to save. See, the Bible says He's not willing that any should perish. Now, there'll be some that'll not be saved. There'll be some that'll say no. But God can and God will if they'll just simply ask Him. Not only is God able to save unto the uttermost, but let me give you just one other thing here when we close. Because of that salvation, He's able to transform lives. He's able to transform lives. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse number 8 says, And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that ye always having sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. I believe when salvation comes, and when God saves a person, genuinely a person gets saved and a person has a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, I believe that there is a change that takes place. You say, how do you know that, preacher? Well, that's what the Bible says, amen. In the book of 2 Corinthians, if you'll turn over there with me, please. Notice what it says, 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And I want to read verses 7 down through verse number 10. Give you a chance to turn there while I'm turning. Notice what it says in verse number 7. The Bible says, and this is Paul speaking here, it says, And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. The messenger of Satan buffeted me. And this word buffet here means this. To rap with a fist. I'm not talking about the song, like singing, what they call singing. Ain't no more singing and I'm an airplane pilot. But this word buffet means to rap or to hit somebody with a fist. The devil, the Bible tells us, as a roaring lion walking about seeketh who he may devour. The devil, the Apostle Paul, being the man of God that he was, the devil still buffeted the Apostle Paul. The devil still gave the Apostle Paul a fit. You know why? Because Paul made a change in his life the day he got saved. Paul never was the same, thank God, after the day that he met the Lord on the road to Damascus. He never was the same after that. He was different. I don't know about you, but November the 23rd, 1967. I haven't been perfect, but I'm telling you there was a change that took place that transformed my life and made a difference in me, and I have not been the same since. Oh yeah, this old flesh is still lost. We're still in this old Adamic nature. There's still been times I've failed the Lord and I've failed God, but there ain't never been a time I've been lost since the day I got saved. Why? Because He changed my life forever. Woo! Glory to God. That'll make you... Well, you ought to be getting ready for revival, amen. We ought to be so excited and pumped up and charged up when Brother Stacy Shefflin gets here, he'll feel like he's backslidden trying to preach to us. Amen? Paul said these things Satan buffeted me, lest I should be exalted above increase, above measure. He says, for this thing I besought the Lord three times, that it may depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, would I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches, in necessities and persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. Amen? Aren't you glad the Bible tells us that when he... And I've heard so many people say this. I just don't think I could live it. You can't. You can't live it. It's Christ that liveth within you, the hope of glory. And that's what we have to look at. And Paul, listen. Hey, I don't know how it would be, but can you just imagine... After Paul got saved, and he run across some of that crowd that he used to run around with. Just think about this part. After Paul got saved, the people that didn't know he got saved were still scared to death of him. But I'll guarantee you, they wasn't around long before they knew that Paul had done something in his life, and there had been a transformed life in the Apostle Paul. He no longer persecuted the church. He no longer persecuted the Christians. He no longer beat and probably cursed them. But I'm telling you, that was such a change. Hey, it didn't take very long for people to find out. And let me just say this tonight. If you're saved by the grace of God and you got saved, hey, your family ought to tell the difference. Your friends ought to tell the difference. Your church people ought to be able to tell the difference when there's a transforming power in your life that takes place because God is able to transform all those lives. Every one of us, sorry as sorry can be. Woo! We don't have to come into church house with our head hung low, Brother Danny. We don't have to come in and be ashamed of what we... Hey, you know why? Because God has transformed our lives and made a difference in our lives. We can come with a head, and I'm talking about being proud and boastful in ourselves, because it's not us. But we can come into the church house with our hands raised and giving God the glory and giving God the praise and giving Him the honor because of what He's done, because He made a difference and He made a change in our lives, amen. He's able to change lives today. I'm not talking about turning over a new leaf. I'm not talking about trying to do better. I'm not talking about trying to straighten up. I'm talking about being blood washed, amen, and God making a difference in our lives. He's able to do that tonight. Oh, glory to God, bless His sweet name. Romans chapter 5, verse number 20, one of my favorite verses in the Bible says, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, whoo, grace did much more abound. I like that song, grace that is greater than all my sins. Hey, that's the kind of grace that we have. Oh, there's so many things we could go into tonight concerning our transformed lives, on how we have a new creation in our life. And Brother David him sings that song, The Old Man's Dead. Brother Smiley likes that song. And old Brother Smiley was an old man, glory to God, when he began to live. 81 years old before the Lord saved his soul. 81 before he found out. Boy, he just started living the day that God saved him. Hey, let me just say, God transformed old Smiley's life too, amen. He used to go down to Brother Larry's, and Brother Smiley would be sitting down there on the carport and with Brother Larry and him, Brother Dennis and him been down there, and Brother Smiley, and Brother Larry would say, preacher, I'm trying to get Smiley to come to church. I've asked him to come. And Brother Larry said this, he won't ever come, preacher. Whoopee. One day he's going to walk up and see old Brother Larry. When he gets the glory, amen. Hallelujah. Hey, they're going to be there forever. You talking about some fellowship. They'll have some fellowship then. Hey, wait. God transformed this old boy's life and made a difference, amen. I remember the night old Brother Jimmy got his life transformed. On a Monday night of a revival that wasn't even planned. That's the reason a lot of times these revival flyers and things like that, you know, sometimes how we plan things. You know, I believe with all my heart a lot of times if we just let God have His way, if we just follow His leadership, if we just follow His guidance, I'll tell you right now, He can do a whole lot more than we can do with our programs, with our planning. And listen, I'm not naive. I know it takes planning. I know you have to prepare. I know you have to get ready. But I'm telling you right now, when God speaks, you better listen to what He has to say. Why? Because God will transform lives. And listen, if you're saved tonight, there should be a difference. You should not want to hear the same old things you used to hear. You should not want to go to the same old places that you used to go. You should not act the same old way that you used to act. You should not dress the same old way that you used to dress. You should not talk the same old way that you used to talk. There should be a difference. The old songwriter says, He made a change in the way that I walk. He made a change in the way that I talk. That's what it's being, a transformed life. God's able tonight. I'm thankful for His ability, His divine ability. And there's many, many other things tonight that we can mention. Time won't allow us to do so. Let's stand with our head bowed and our eyes closed. Let me just ask you tonight. Are you trusting God to do the impossible in your life? Are you trusting God to do the impossible in your family and on your job? Among your children, among your grandchildren, among your friends. Sister Linda's playing. If you need to come tonight, just slip out and make your way down to this altar. If you're here tonight and you've never trusted Christ as your Savior. You need to get saved tonight, just slip out. Young person, middle age, older person, doesn't, whoever you are. You say, well, preacher, I've been in church all my life. Doesn't make any difference how long you've been in church. But the most important thing is, do you know Jesus personally as your Savior? Do you have something tonight that you can die by? Do you have something tonight that you can trust to get you to heaven? There's some at the altar. There may be some others that need to come. Would you slip out and make your way down? Altar's open tonight if you'd like to come and just pray for revival. We don't need to come and pray that God will give somebody else revival. We need to come and pray and ask God to send us revival to our hearts. You might want to come tonight. Just slip out and make your way down to the altar. Say, Lord, it's not my brother, it's not my sister, but it's me, O Lord, that standeth in the need of prayer and standeth in the need of revival in my heart. Would you slip out and come, make your way down to this altar? Others have come. Follow the leadership of the Lord and do what He would ask you to do tonight. Look, I want us to be ready for revival. I want us to plead and ask God to send revival our way. I want us to experience revival in our church. I want us to be able to say that week, Lord, I've never seen it on this fashion. Have time to come while these are praying. We'll be going home here in just a few moments. Appreciate you coming tonight. I've enjoyed preaching and enjoyed the good spirit of the Lord being here. Enjoyed the good singing, the good fellowship with His people. Folk, I really want you to pray for revival. Don't forget Saturday morning, men. But I want you to pray a lot more than Saturday morning. Pray at home. Pray on your way to job. Pray on the way to work. Pray on the way home from work. When you say your blessing, when you have your lunch, say, Lord, would you please send revival to Emmanuel Baptist Church? God won't get tired of hearing us. Just pray He'll send it. Appreciate having our visitors with us tonight. Appreciate you being here. Appreciate those that have been real faithful in coming. I just thank the Lord for it. Remember all the requests and pray God's will be done concerning each and every one. We're going to be dismissed in a word of prayer. You be careful going home And don't forget homecoming. Bring somebody with you homecoming. Call some of our people up that no longer come. That's what homecoming's about. Call them up and ask them to come and be a part of our homecoming services. Bring a full basket. Amen. Bring two baskets. Bring one full and bring one empty. I'm not talking about taking leftovers home. I'm talking about getting something from the Word and getting that spiritual basket filled up for the glory of God. There'll be some things that need to be done from now to Sunday. Setting the fellowship hall up, getting it ready, so anybody can come out and help you anytime. That'd be a real blessing. We're going to dismiss so Brother Rick can get the choir up here just as quick as he can and go over that stuff.